Welcome to the Farming Without the Bank podcast, the show with a no BS approach to money, hosted by a farm strategy expert and authorized IBC practitioner. Join us as we get real and expose the flaws of traditional financial institutions in order to help farmers take control of their finances, create peace of mind, grow their wealth, and leave a legacy. Now, here's your host, Mary Jo Ehrman.
Hello and welcome to today's podcast. Thank you once again for joining in. I very much appreciate it. If you guys are liking this podcast, please share. I would be very grateful for that. There are a lot of people out there looking for podcasts to listen to, and the only way to find some of them is by sharing. Okay, let's get started. Today am going to talk about how to get started from scratch. And I keep getting this question over and over and over. And I usually address it privately because it's not really what I do. I don't help people get started from scratch. I don't help people find financing. I'm really just helping people create a pool of money with income that they're already earning. And so for a long time, I've just not talked about this subject because I don't feel like I'm the expert in it. I have talked to tons of people that have started on their own. I've got ideas of how people can do it, but I can't say that I help people do it. And so I've just kind of avoided the subject, to be honest. But I want to address it today because so many people are talking about it. And so let me just preface this with the fact that this is just from what I've heard. I am not an expert. I am sure there are other things that people are doing. There are places you can reach out for financing, those sort of things. But I don't know about them because that's just, again, not what I'm focusing on. But if you are out there and you're listening and you're saying, hey, I want to start from scratch, what have your clients done? What are you suggesting? What are you seeing? Well, that's what you're going to hear today, my friends, is what am I seeing? So first of all, I think the first thing that I see a lot when we say, you know, I want to start farming, you're going to have to start small. If you want, let's say you want a ranch, well, I shouldn't say, you can't. I don't like the word can't. You can't do something. That is just an absolute excuse to me. So you may not want to buy 1,500 acres or 10,000 acres to ranch on, you know, and go buy 500 head of cows. We might have to start small. And it's okay to start small and then work your way up to where you want to be and have a plan to do that. Talk to other people that have done it. Research it just like you would research anything else. What are they doing and how can you, you know, and why are they successful and how can you do what they're doing on just a smaller scale? Like I've talked to people that, oh, I want a ranch. I've never ranched before, but I want a ranch. And, you know, I live in the part of the country where ranching is huge. And so I'm going to need like 3,000 acres. If you've never ranched before, maybe start with 40 acres and learn about rotational grazing. And maybe you can do some rotational grazing and you can have more cattle on that same piece of land. Land is one of the most expensive things. And that is the biggest issue with people is they say, well, I can't afford to buy land. I'm never going to be able to farm because I can't afford to buy land. This is why we can't get started is because we can't afford to buy land. Okay, people are buying land all the time. And I talk to people that are starting out buying land. So never is not never. You never will be able to afford to buy land. How can you afford to buy land? How can you do those things? And just to expand that question, because I think that's where a lot of people are stuck too, is, well, I can't afford to do that. Okay, but how can you afford to do it? you might have to work an off the farm job. You're not, you know, I had somebody on Facebook one day post and said, well, you can't, oh, I forget exactly how he said it. Something about you can't, nobody can start from scratch. And I said, what do you mean nobody can start from scratch? There are people doing it. And he said, well, you can't do it full time. And you can't farm full time from scratch. I said, who said you are supposed to? If I'm a business owner, how many business owners do you know that have a business and that's they're starting it part time and they're working a full time job to do so? So business owners start it part time. A lot of business owners who try to start it full time may fail. There's a fine line between being there full time and making sure that that time is producing income. And so, and he didn't really have, I don't remember what his comment was, but nobody said, I'm not sitting here saying you can do it and you're not going to have to work your ass off. You're going to have to work. It's not going to be easy, but it's possible. And the people that I've talked to that have done it have worked an off the farm job. They have bought a little piece of land, 10 acres, and they 40 acres, and they gradually expand, or 120 acres. And I've had clients that I've talked to that they have bought land and then they've worked a deal out with the neighbor. They'll go help the neighbor, they'll provide labor in exchange for the use of a piece of equipment. And, you know, if that's an opportunity and you can make a deal with the neighbor, well, not only did you gain a mentor, but you also got some equipment that if you only need it a couple of times a year, great. I've seen people on within Facebook groups that I'm in for farming, they'll go buy the oldest darn tractor you've ever seen. And they are so super proud of it because it's what they could afford. It's their first tractor. It gets them through. We don't need to have the nicest of equipment. You don't need to have the newest, greatest, latest, whatever in order to start farming. And those people that do have the newest, greatest, latest, that could very well be getting them into financial trouble. So don't be looking across the fence and saying, hey, this is what I want because neighbor John, who is 60 and 70 years old, he has the latest, greatest, newest. Well, A, he's 60 or 70, and B, do you know what his finances are? Don't tell somebody what they can and can't do with their numbers if you don't know their numbers. If you're not living in their shoes and you don't know what's going on, we don't have a right to be looking and being envy or judging because we don't know what that is. Now, if we know how they're doing financially and we know they're doing okay, great. I read an article yesterday. I don't remember what magazine it was in. It was in a farming magazine. And it was talking about how this farmer had to completely sell out because he went to four different banks and couldn't get a loan. Well, we have a problem. And he said in the article, I bought equipment I didn't need. The old stuff worked just fine, but I was buying new stuff when times were good. So if you're going to start and you have an off the farm job, my suggestion would be to say, okay, I'm putting X amount of dollars away and I am saving so that I can buy land because I know what the land value is. I know how much I need to save. I'm going to work two jobs to save to be able to buy that land. I'm going to get owner financing. I'm going to go to FSA and get a first-time farm loan. And I'm not a, I mean, obviously I talk about FSA in the book and how I don't love them, but they do have good farm loans. Just make sure they're not going to control every single red cent that comes in to your house because they will if you allow them to. And it depends on the loan officer. Some are better than others. Some don't like beginning farmers because it's maybe higher risk and they don't have, you know, they've become complacent themselves. They've got the arrival syndrome. They have no vision, whatever it is, however you want to call it. Okay. So, I've had there. Here's another option that a lot of people don't think about is if you can buy 10 acres and you want chickens. And, you know, in those of you that are listening that are in the traditional sense of the word of farming, and you think you need to have a lot of acres to grow wheat and corn and soybeans and pulse crops, and you got to have a bunch of cattle and they got to be Black Angus. On the contrary, let's expand our vision just a hair. Okay. Just a hair. If you are starting out, you get some chickens? Okay. So you've got some chickens. Doesn't matter. You're selling eggs. Maybe you're butchering and you're selling the chickens. Maybe you're providing them to somebody else and you've got a little gig going. I mean, people are starting, if you're going to start small, you start small. Maybe you have a 1 acre garden. Maybe you grow just enough corn that you can sell the cobs and people will feed them to their squirrels. You guys, the stuff that I see people doing is absolutely crazy. Like, I have one client who plants sunflowers and they stagger them. And then people will pay to come take pictures in the sunflowers. Like, I think that's crazy. It's a sunflower. Like, you can go anywhere in North Dakota and just stand by the side of the road and be taking pictures in sunflowers. Right? You're trespassing, but you can do it. And people are paying to do this. Where do you live? Is there something of value that you can provide to somebody near a bigger city or even in a city? I talked to a lady one time who has a 1 acre garden and she's planting lettuce and making quite a bit of money selling lettuce. And it's a couple bucks for seeds. Have a strawberry patch and let people come out and pick their own strawberries. Bag, you can, maybe you have 40 acres and you're going to grow some oats. And you can harvest that oats and bag it and sell it to people to feed deer, to feed squirrels. Same with corn. If you want 40 acres and you don't have the money for cows, you can custom graze. You can find somebody that's looking for somebody to have some cows and custom graze, because maybe somebody else has cows, but they don't have the land, or they want the cows, but they don't have the land. It's no different than somebody buying land and renting it out to people who want horses or people who have horses, right? Like, there's so much opportunity there. If you want the land, how can you get it? What are the things you can do? We think if we plant corn, we need to harvest it and haul it to the ethanol plant, or we need to haul it to the elevator. Right? If you have corn, can you bag it, sell it for squirrel feed, and then you have the silage for somebody that's got hogs? How you can get started is small. I don't know any of these people that have gotten started and they just jumped right in and bought as many things as they can. No. And hopefully as time goes, maybe I can interview some of my clients that have started from scratch and we can kind of share how they did it. But we have to have the vision. I think the biggest thing is having the vision. How do you want to do it? Challenge yourself. I had a friend call me the other night and she said, Mary Jo, I just don't know. I just don't know. Should I? She moved for her job. She had to move across the country for her job. And she said, I just don't know. Should I buy an apartment, or should I rent an apartment? Should I buy a house? That way I can keep my horse there. What do I do? And I said, well, why don't you buy a condo and then just board the horse? Oh, I hadn't thought of that option. I only thought of renting and boarding, or buying and having the horse on my own land. The option of still buying, but boarding, because sometimes buying is cheaper, right? So it was just a different perspective, because a lot of times we get so stuck in what we are doing that, or how we want to do it, that we just don't allow ourselves to see another way or a bigger vision. And those people that are starting from scratch, if you have an off-the-farm job, that is a great opportunity to be starting a life insurance policy for cash value growth and implementing the infinite banking concept so that you have an opportunity to be borrowing against that yourself. Maybe you can't use that to buy the land, but maybe you can use that in the future to buy the cows, to buy a piece of equipment, to do whatever. That is, I love it when I have a young farmer with an off-the-farm job, because we have an opportunity to create the pool of money and to start that bank. Where if you don't have an off-the-farm job and you're trying to farm full-time and get started, there's not a lot there. I have people that are using credit cards in order to finance things as they get started. Now, I don't suggest that unless you got like a 0% card for 12 or 18 months or whatever they are. But be very careful, because that can get you into trouble. So be very, very careful when you're doing that, if that is your only option. But I'm telling you, there are people that want to do it and it is their only option. Because you might have, I mean, we have a local lady that she's got quite a decent little business, and she's got chickens and she sells the eggs, and she's got ducks and she sells duck eggs, and I buy the duck eggs. I can have duck eggs, but I'm allergic to chicken eggs apparently. So there is a need for that. And guess how many people in our area have ducks? Very few, very, very few. First of all, they're messier than I'll get out, but they are pretty cute compared to a chicken, in my opinion. So if you've got, if there is, where is there a need and can you fulfill it? Can you start small? I have a gentleman that I talked to the other day. They started small. They bought a piece of land here and there, and now they're having to sell one piece because it's just not blending in. It's not really making any money. So there's another option. Don't be scared to change what you're doing. Don't be so locked in to what you're doing that you don't have that you don't have an opportunity to pivot. We might have to pivot. And even if you're a big operation and you're not pivoting, why? If corn is worth nothing and all of a sudden pulse crops are worth a lot, why? Why are we raising Angus? If we can do the same amount of if we can have the same amount of cash flow and generate the same amount of income with a different breed. I don't know how many people, and I don't know them, and I'm not plugging them by any stretch of the imagination, but I have been introduced to Faro Cattle Company. And some people think it's complete hogwash. Some people think it's great. I've been introduced to them. I've looked at their stuff. It makes a little bit of sense to me, even though I'm not out there, I'm not the one raising cattle. But if you can buy a smaller cow and it's more productive with energy as far as how it's utilizing its food, and you're selling per pound and you're making per pound, and they're talking about how many pounds can you graze per acre or something like that. It's a completely different way of thinking for cattle than what the traditional thought process is. And so he's not the Angus guy. He's talking about smaller cattle that you can buy cheaper. That's a whole nother avenue. And there are so many things like that out there. There are, if you're going to buy 10 acres, why don't you have some hair sheep? Okay. Yeah, they die. They're pretty finicky. They are not exactly the easiest thing to raise. I've talked to quite a few people and got a couple clients with hair sheep. And I had one guy tell me that sheep merely are sniffing the ground just so they can figure out where they want to just keel over. I think it's absolutely hilarious because we never had sheep. I don't really know anything about sheep. I just know people's numbers, and people that have hair sheep are making some decent money. But there is a way to raise them. you can throw them in with cows and you can, you know, utilize your ground a little better. So if I have some small acreage, maybe I want to have a couple cows. Maybe I want to have hair sheep. Maybe you end up with the old McDonald farm. But if the old McDonald farm is going to make you some money and make you happy, great. I have some clients in New York. I have a couple young clients in New York who are absolutely awesome doing organic dairy. But I also, I talked to another young couple in New York and they have started 100% from scratch on their own. They both have off the farm jobs. They have started with, you know, they've got some chickens, they've got some hogs, they've got a couple cows, they're doing direct to consumer. Along the way, they've built a little store for themselves. They have honey, they've got bees, so they sell some of their own honey. I mean, it's just absolutely awesome to see. And it's so exciting to me when I talk to those people because so many people tell me it can't be done. And it can be done. It can. You just have to want it bad enough to do it. And you have to stretch your mind to figure out how am I going to get it done? And stretching your mind is not you sitting at your job all day and then coming home and feeling sorry for yourself because you want to be farming. Stretching your mind is listening to podcasts, listening to things of how are people doing this? What are they doing and how, what can I do? Where is there a need and how can I fulfill it? Just like the young guy I talked to a week or two ago who had, he's raising shrimp. He is starting a shrimp farm and apparently starting a shrimp farm in the Midwest is a big deal. They're using old hog barns to start shrimp farms. There is a company in Illinois that raises shrimp and they do it on dry land. You don't have to have the ocean. And that is amazing. That is absolutely, utterly amazing to me. I had a young guy whose dad, they grow almonds. And the almond prices are not very good right now. And so they're struggling a little bit. And I said, well, why don't you package the almonds and sell them direct? Well, dad doesn't want to. I said, I don't care what dad wants to do. Why don't you buy some almonds from dad and get your label and package them and sell them and see how it goes. Start small and see if dad will let you buy however many pounds of almonds and see if you can sell them and set the website up and whatever that looks like. I don't know what those costs are, but do the due diligence to find out. And so even if you're farming with dad and you're like, well, how do I get started? Dad's not giving me anything. No, mom and dad typically don't give you anything. And so if they're not going to give it to you, how do you create some of it on your own and go out on your own and do it? Do you have one? Do you run cows with them and you have a couple beef and are you going to sell them direct to consumer? I mean, the ideas are endless. And I seem to have an abundance of ideas as I talk to people. And it's super fun for me to just throw out ideas. But I get those ideas because I'm constantly stretching my mind. I'm constantly listening to what other people are doing. And I am 100% genuinely interested. So I ask a bazillion questions. I mean, you might come into a meeting with me and you might be doing something that's a little bit out of the norm. And it might take me 15 minutes just to get back on track to how you can start your own infinite banking concept policy, right? But I want to know what you're doing and I'm genuinely interested. I've talked to people that are growing grass seed. So you don't need a ton of land to be growing grass seed. How does that work? Who do you sell it to? Where do you go with it? Like we just planted some grass. We just put some seed down and I don't even think about where it comes from, right? It's like people that don't think about where their meat comes from. I didn't even think about, well, duh, somebody's got to grow it. Somebody's got to harvest it. They've got to package it. They've got to put it in the stores. Hello. I mean, I've got a client who shows dairies how to turn their waste into a mulch. I mean, it's a much bigger process than that. But if you're a dairy farmer, is that something you can supplement with? Or can you go to the dairy who's turning it into mulch and say, hey, I'll bag it for you? I mean, I don't know. I'm just throwing ideas out there. But there is always a way to do something. It's just, how are you going to do it? Stretch your mind. Listen to podcasts. There are a ton of farm podcasts. I have not listened to all of them, obviously, but there is one called Off the Farm Income. And that guy talks, the few that I've listened to there, that guy talks a lot about starting small and doing some smaller things. I don't know him, but you might want to check that one out. There is also, I'm just looking at my podcast here, sorry. Regenerative Agriculture Podcast. I've not really listened to that one a lot. Damian Mason, The Business of Agriculture. That's a good one. Just kind of talking about where everything is going. Thriving Farmer Podcast. And then, of course, my all-time favorite, Working Cows Podcast. That one is super good. Super, super good. Working Cows. You're going to want to tune into Clay's for sure. And he talks a lot about just other things that can generate some income as well and being smart about it income-wise. And then I have an Off the Husk one in my podcast list. And I can't tell you that I 100% remember any of those episodes, but I haven't deleted it. So that probably means it's pretty good. I do not listen to podcasts that talk about news. Agriculture news, what's going on in the market. I know that's all important and that's probably important to you if you're selling stuff, but they are not giving ideas. They are not creating a solution to the problem. All they keep talking about is the problem, and I get sick and tired of hearing about problems and I want solutions. And that is not helping me create a solution. It's not stretching my mind. It is not stretching your mind. Being aware is great. And if you want to dive into the markets and you want to understand all that stuff, fantastic. But I really, really encourage you to go out and find things that people are doing differently, because that's what's going to stretch you. That's what's going to give you those ideas. How are you going to get financing for it? I mean, you guys, there's credit cards, there's contract for deeds. Just be creative. How can I do it? How do I save enough money? Do I need a partner? There's another thing. Can I have an investor? Do I have a friend, 3, 4, 5 friends that can start together? And if we're going to have other people start with us, just make sure there's an agreement up front that A, everybody has to work, and maybe I want to buy you out in so many years, so it's not a very long-term investment for the other person that's, you know, getting into the business or getting into farming with you. So there are lots of ways. A lot of people don't want to be partners because they're very independent. And farmers are typically very independent thinking people. It's, I want to do it and I want to do it on my own. But if you want to get started and you want help to get started, then great. Get yourself some help and then make sure that you have a buyout plan so that you don't have to be answering to somebody else forever. Okay. I don't know that I have a whole lot more to add to that subject. Usually when I talk to somebody, that's when the ideas flow. But, you know, if you have an off the farm job, can you create that bank so that when you're ready, you don't have to borrow from the bank? And not everything has to happen today. Be patient about it. I think that is probably the biggest thing, is we want it and we want it today. And the people that have started on their own from scratch have been patient and they've been willing to build it. If you are not patient and you're not willing to build it and it's all or nothing, you're going to end up with nothing. You can't go, it's go big or go home is what everybody wants to do, right? I want to be big. Nobody got big overnight. And big is perspective, you know. Some people 500 acres is big. Some people 50,000 acres is big. Big is what you make it. So be patient, have a plan, Look at the numbers. Oh, for heaven's sakes, I can't believe I almost forgot this one. Look at the numbers. You guys, I have talked to people who want to start on their own, and they have never looked at the numbers. They have no idea what a tractor costs. They have no idea what land costs, but they want a farm. Holy moly. You gotta look at the numbers. You need to know what you're doing. You can't just jump into any business and not know what it's gonna cost you. Watch it. You might have to spend a year or two doing research and watching it, or call everybody in the world and, you know, call whoever and get an idea of what things are gonna cost and what happened in the past. What are markets like for that particular product? Like, you have to have an idea what it's going to cost you to start an operation on your own. How much is land? How much are cows? What's the income going to be? What are the operating expenses going to be? If you haven't done the numbers, then you're dreaming. You're absolutely dreaming. Once you put pen to paper, now we can make it a reality. But if you never know where to begin, you're just going to go in circles. Okay. I hope that helped. You guys, if you have not gotten my Farming Without the Bank book yet, please do so. And hey, we've released something new. If you go to farmingwithoutthebank.com and you go to the store, we have a new storefront. And it is so much more functional than our old one, which is absolutely fantastic. And so we have bundles on there. We have a few more bundles on there now. And we have the audio. And you can get my hard copy book now with the audio as a bundle. So you get the hard copy book and you get the audio. Also, Wealth Without the Bank or Wall Street, which is my second book, that is also on audio now. Yay! I'm so excited. So you can also get the hard copy and the audio, or just get the audio. But please go there, because there are bundles of books. It's so much easier to navigate. There are lots of videos from past conferences. So that's fantastic, because you can get those videos, especially from the Farm Finance Conference that I had in Nashville in 2018. You get to hear me talk to Nelson. You get to hear about estate planning. I had Mark Davis speak about crop marketing. And there is just so many good videos on there. Long-term care, Don Quante has something with long-term care. And then, of course, there's like some t-shirts and hoodies and stuff with Farming Without the Bank stuff. So, but the books are great. The new store is fantastic. So go to farmingwithoutthebank.com, click on store, and you can look over other books that you've not, maybe you haven't heard those books, or maybe you haven't read those books, or you didn't even know those books existed. But if they're good books, they're on my website. So as always, thank you very, very much for listening. I appreciate it. Let me know if you want to hear me talk about anything, if you have comments, concerns, thoughts, whatever. MaryJo@withoutthebank.com. You can email me there and we are happy to answer any of your questions. Otherwise, if you have not, you can follow me on Facebook. I do quite a few Facebook lives and I'm very active on Facebook. There is Instagram, there is YouTube, and we've got LinkedIn and all the other stuff. So if you want to follow me, please do so. If you want to share this, please do so. I very much appreciate it. Anyway, you guys have an absolutely fantastic day, and thanks for joining in again.
Thanks for listening to the Farming Without the Bank podcast. We hope today's episode has inspired you to take control of your finances in new ways. Don't forget to check out our website, farmingwithoutthebank.com, and engage with us on our Facebook page, Farming Without the Bank. Join us next week as we smash more financial myths and empower you to accomplish your financial goals.